الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد My dear brothers and sisters, we listened to a series of khutbas in the last few weeks on what is our brand. And therefore I thought it's a good idea to culminate it with a with a khutbah on the absolute foundation of it, which is what is Islam. It's very important to understand what Islam is because we claim to follow Islam. And therefore it's very important for us to understand what it is that we are following. 1447 years ago, a window opened in the heavens. I am talking about a historical fact. I am not talking about philosophy or mythology. 1447 years ago, a window opened in the heavens and God spoke to man. In the words of Leslie Hazelton, the wonderful YouTube video where she said a wonderful thing. She's written a book on the seerah of Rasulullah ﷺ, on the biography of Rasulullah ﷺ. And she said that when Muhammad ﷺ received the first message, he didn't come off the mountain on the wings of angels. He didn't float in the air and come to the earth. He didn't come singing hallelujah or something. He didn't come with a halo around his head. He came like an ordinary human being, frightened and afraid, because he had experienced something which no human being had experienced before that. The meeting of two life forms. The meeting of a life form of light, of nur. The malak, the amir of the malaika, Jibreel alayhi salam, with a human being. And he experienced that meeting like any human being. And he came off the mountain frightened. And he came to his wife and he said, Zammiluni, Zammiluni. He said, cover me, cover me. And he explained what had happened to him and he was frightened. And she said that this is the proof that what he experienced was true. I want you to understand one thing very clearly, which I have mentioned many times before. Islam has no mythology in it. Islam has no conjecture and philosophy in it. Islam is not an ideology or a philosophy. Islam is a reality. Islam is history, recorded history. And 1447 years ago is when it began in this form. Now this opening of the window in the heavens, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke through his messenger Jibreel alayhi salam to his messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This opening of a window in the heavens when God spoke to man was not the first time it had happened. But it was to be the last time that it would happen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the first ayat of his kalam, of his message which was to be spread over the next 23 years. And that ayat was, Iqra, Bismi Rabbika Allazi Khalaq. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, read, in the name of the one who created everything. That message began with drawing attention to his creation. It began with the word read. Read the message of the glory and majesty and magnificence of your Rabb in what he created. In the massive and the minute. In the exceptional and the mundane. In the unique and the multitude. Read and recognize the reality behind the message. In fact, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator himself, defined this ability to recognize the reality behind the signs as the single most important sign of intelligence. Not some IQ or EQ test, but the ability to recognize the reality behind the signs. Not get lost in the signs and deny the reality behind those signs. If someone sees the footprints of a lion and says the lion does not exist, then he has to wait for a few minutes to discover if the lion exists or not. But that is not the sign of an intelligent person. It's not even the sign of somebody who has a reasonably long lifespan. Because there is only one result when the lion finds you. Unless, of course, the lion looks at you and says, I don't eat junk food. So what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say about this sign of intelligence? In Surah Al Imran, in the ayah which you have heard me recite a million times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن في خلق السماوات والأرض واختلاف الليل والنهار لآيات لأولي الألباب الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم الذين يذكرون الله قياما وقعودا وعلى جنوبهم ويتفكرون في خلق السماوات والأرض ربنا ما خلقت هذا باطلا سبحانك فقنا عذاب النار. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned and he said, verily in the creation of the heavens and the earth and in the alternation of the night and the day, there are indeed signs for people of understanding. Al-ulil al-bab. People of intelligence. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described who are the people of intelligence. Remember, this is not my description. This is the description of the one who created the people and who created intelligence itself. And what does he say? He says, who are these people? Alladhina. He said, they are those yadhkuruna allaha qiyaman wa qu'udan wa ala junubihim, who remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who mention Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala standing, sitting and lying down. The beauty of the bayan of the kalam of Allah jalla wa ala. And this example of the bayan of the Quran, you see all through the Quran. In one or two words, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encapsulates every aspect of our life. Qiyamah wa qu'udah wa ala junubihim. Standing, sitting and lying down, there is no fourth position. Someone who recognizes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Someone who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Standing, sitting and lying down. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used another word. He used the preposition and. Wow. Wayatafakkaroon. People of intelligence are those who recognize their Rabb and who reflect. Khalqis samawati wal ard. Who reflect on the creation of the heavens and the earth. This separation between religion and scientific education that we find today is man-made. It is created by us. This is the ultimate level of stupidity. This is not in the kalam of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is no conflict in Islam between science and theology. Because science is a manifestation of theology. Science is the signs of the Creator. How can there possibly be a conflict between the sign and the reality behind that sign? How can there be a conflict between the footprint, between the pug mark of a lion and the lion itself? This is man-made. This is created by us. Very stupid. We must get rid of this. The Quran teaches us both the relationship and the sequence of learning. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, who are the people of intelligence? Those of you who understand Arabic, you know that if this ayah had been written the other way around, instead of saying Alladheena yadhkuruna Allaha qiyaman wa qu'udan wa ala junubihim, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said Alladheena yatafakkaruna fi khalqi samawati wal ard wa yatafakkaruna wa yadhkurun, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had changed the order of the terms, nothing, there would not be grammatically in Arabic, there would be no problem. The ayah could have still been written in that way, except one thing, which is that the meaning would be different. That the sequence of learning would have changed. The reason for atheism is because the sequence of learning is changed. Atheism happens because the learning sequence is changed. Before recognizing the Creator, when we delve into the creation, we cannot understand the creation. We cannot understand the creation. It confuses us. And all our intelligence and all our reasoning and all our reckoning hits us against a stone wall. And that stone wall is the question, why? Why did this happen? And there is no answer. And as I have explained to you before, we try to answer the question why with the word how. We give the same answer to the why as we would give to the how. And that is stupidity. That's also a sign of complete intellectual helplessness, intellectual bankruptcy, the unwillingness, the integrity to recognize reality. But believe me, reality does not change because we don't want to recognize it. And that is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this sequence. First, recognize your Rabb. Then look at the creation and everything will make sense. Everything will make sense. And that's why he said, يَتَفَكَّرُونَ فِي خَلْقِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. And what is the result of that? رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا. Oh Allah, you have not created this in vain. This creation is not an accident. Accidents break things, they don't make things. If your car is not working, go have an accident, it will become alright. If your head is aching, walk into a wall, it will become okay. Crazy, right? Then how is it sensible to say this world is an accident? رَبَّنَا مَا خَلَقْتَ هَذَا بَاطِلًا. Oh Allah, oh our Rabb, this creation is not an accident. You didn't create it in vain. You just didn't create it to trash it. Subhanak. All glory be to you. فَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. And save us from the hellfire. My brothers and sisters, recognize this deen of ours. Recognize this deen of ours. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created this universe. And within it, He set some fundamental laws. Very precise fundamental laws and very precise constants which guide and run it. There is a very precise calculation to the angle of the earth on its axis. It's not at 90 degrees. It's not at 180 degrees. There is a very specific angle at which the earth is on its axis. There is a very specific speed by which it rotates. And so on and so on. Very, very precise. Find me an accident which is precise. Very precise. There are very precise fundamental laws. And there are very precise constants. For example, one fundamental law which we are all very familiar with is the law of gravity. Gravity is the magnetic force which pulls everything in the atmosphere of the earth towards the earth, towards the center of the earth. And thank God for gravity, because if gravity wasn't there, you and I would be orbiting the earth, because we would be thrown off by another fundamental law called centrifugal force. We would not be able to sit here. And if that gravity, if the strength of that gravity was more than it is, then we would not be able to move. We would not be able to fly. We would not even be able to walk, let alone fly. Because the huge force with which gravity would pull us to the earth would anchor our feet on the surface of the earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created gravity and He decreed the specific strength of that gravity. The extreme example of gravity is the black hole, where the gravitational force is so strong that even light cannot escape. And this is the reason, gravity is the reason behind the acceleration of any object that is falling towards the earth. And what is the rate of the acceleration? 9.8 meters per second square. 32 feet per second square. 32 feet per second per second. This acceleration due to gravity is a constant. What does that mean? It means that if a hammer and a feather are dropped from a height in a vacuum, they will both reach the bottom at the same time. At the same time. But if you take a hammer and a feather to the top of this building and drop, the hammer reaches the earth much faster than the feather. Why? Because of another fundamental law, and that is air drag. Air drag acts on the surface area, and therefore the feather floats to earth, whereas the hammer comes down with a bang. But if you take the hammer and the feather, and they actually did an experiment on the moon to prove this, if you take the hammer and the feather and drop them in a vacuum, they will both fall with exactly the same speed, and they will both reach the bottom exactly at the same time. However, I am not standing here to teach physics. I strongly recommend that you watch lessons of physics, lectures on physics by a wonderful, wonderful teacher in MIT, a guy called Walter Lewin. Go and Google Walter Lewin. Walter Lewin has more than 2 million viewers per day. Watch his lectures on physics. Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. So Google Walter Lewin. It's all there on YouTube. I am saying all of this to explain only one single fact. And that fact is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who created this entire universe, of which our earth is a minuscule particle. And He is the one who created the fundamental laws that govern whatever happens on this earth and whatever happens in the entire universe, that of which we know and that of which we don't know. Now, why must we know fundamental laws? And the answer is, we need not know fundamental laws, except when we are going to go into an area where a fundamental law operates. And then we need to know that fundamental law. For example, do you need to know the laws of aerodynamics, which are fundamental laws? No. Except when you want to fly a plane. If you want to fly a plane, then you better learn the laws of aerodynamics, otherwise you will crash. And that also is a fundamental law. That those who refuse to follow fundamental laws will crash. That also is a fundamental law. My brothers and sisters, for centuries, humanity has spent time in conjecture, in philosophy, in fantasy, in intellectualization, wondering about one reality which nobody in the world denies. And what is that reality? Death. Death. People deny everything, including the Creator, but nobody denies death. There are people who say after we die, nothing will happen. There are people who say after we die, we get reincarnated in one form or another, depending on the kind of life we lived. There are people who say after we die, we go to heaven or hell. Bottom line question to ask is, how do you know? Because no one came and told us. No one came back to tell us. So how do you know? Especially those who say, by definition, those who say after we die, we become dust, nothing will happen. By definition, they just wiped out their own proof. They just wiped out their own proof by their own statement. Because if you become dust, then obviously nothing can come back and tell you. So how do you know? I don't know, something is wrong with our brains. Question is, how do we know? And that is where we come to another part. And that part is, just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created fundamental laws in this world, He created fundamental laws in that part of His creation which we in Islam call Al-Ghaib. Al-Ghaib. The unperceivable. Not the unseen as it is usually translated. The unperceivable. Something which can never be perceived no matter what. Fundamental laws of this creation we know and we can discover. Conjecturally, we can say that what we don't know today, we will come to know a century down the road, maybe 10,000 years down the road. Allah knows how long He wants to keep this world here. But yes, logically speaking, one day we will come to know. But there is one fundamental law that we can never know, and that is what happens after we die. And mankind understands this. Every single person on the face of the planet, if he has got a functioning brain, recognizes this. And that is why reams and reams and reams have been written about what people think will happen, including that nothing will happen. If nothing will happen, then why do you write about it? Why are you bothered? Nothing will happen. But you don't know that nothing will happen. And that's why you are bothered. But as I said, what's the question to ask? How do you know? How do you know? Now, therefore, how can we know what will happen after we die? Only one way. If we listen to the one who does not die. How can we know what will happen after we die? Only one way. Whether you like it or not. Whether you like it or not. How do you know what will happen after you die? If you listen to the one who does not die. Al-Hayyu Allazi La Yamut Jalla Jalalu Amma Nawalu Fatir Samawati Wal Ard Khaliqu Samawati Wal Ard Rabbul Alameen رَبِّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ مَالِكِ يَوْمِ الدِّينِ He is the one who can tell us. He is the only one who can tell us. So let us see what he said. Let us see what he said. I'm not going to translate in detail because again Jumaa, lack of time. So look up the translations, but I will give you gists. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the first surah of the 30th juz, Surah An-Naba, Allah began describing what happened in the world and what continues to happen, which I mentioned, which is argument and debate and conjecture and philosophy and intellectualization. What will happen after death? And He said, Jalla Jalaluhu, He said, what are they arguing about? Are they arguing about that great event? The event of resurrection, the event when we will meet our Creator, whether or not we like it, whether or not we believe in Him, whether or not we accept it, we will meet Him. So Allah says, what are they arguing about? Are they arguing about that? And this is a rhetorical question because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what they are arguing about. He knows even before the argument came into their minds. It's a rhetorical question to draw our attention to the time that we spend in trying to discover something which is undiscoverable. instead of reading about it and listening to the one who told us in clear terms. And Allah said, they will find out. He said, truly one day they will find out. He said, A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Amma yatasalun anin nabayil azim alladhi hum fihi mukhtalifun. Kalla sayalamun thumma kalla sayalamun. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described for us that which we can see. Out of that which we can see, He also mentioned some things which at the time of this revelation were unknown, but which today we know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, do they not see the earth as we have spread it? Do they not see the mountains that we have placed on this earth as pegs? Like 10 pegs. Today, when the ayat was revealed, the isostasy of mountains, the geological phenomena by which the mountains anchor the tectonic plates was unknown. But today we know this phenomena. We know that mountains have roots which are much longer than the height of the mountain. And that these mountains balance the earth. Without the mountains balancing the earth would be in a permanent state of earthquakes. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we have created the night for rest and the day for people to earn their living. He said, we have created sleep. Ask the one who cannot sleep the value of sleeping. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, we have created your mates. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then said that He mentioned the precipitation cycle, and He said that we have created rain. And He said, we have created rain, which helps you to grow your crops, which results in thick growth. And He said, Alam najali al-ardha mihada wal jibala awtada wa khalaqnakum azwaja wa ja'alna nawmakum thubata wa ja'alna al-layla libasa wa ja'alna an-nahara ma'asha wa banayna fawqakum sab'an shidada. The skies wa ja'alna sirajan wahaja. The sun, not an object of worship, not something you descended from Suryavanshi or Chandravanshi, an object of creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A star which tells you that the Creator is far superior to that. A star which has no significance in terms of the universe. We don't worship the sun. We don't worship the moon. We don't worship created stuff. We worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who created all of them. وَجَعَلْنَا سِرَاجًا وَهَّاجًا وَأَنزَلْنَا مِنَ الْمُعْصِرَاتِ مَاءً سَجَّاجًا لِنُخْرِجَ بِهِ حَبًّا وَنَبَاتًا وَجَنَّاتٍ أَلْفَافًا. Why did He explain all of this to us? Because He wants us to see the signs. Because He is now going to tell us something which is in the realm of the unperceivable. Something which we will go through, but which we today have no means of knowing, and which we can never ever have a means of knowing. None of our science and technology will take us beyond the barrier of life and death. And He described that scene. And He said, a day will come when you will be called forth, when the sword will be blown, and you will come out of your graves. And don't imagine that if you don't have a grave, you don't come out. Even if you get atomized, if you are in the center of an atomic explosion, and you get atomized, the one who created you when you did not even exist, for Him it is very easy to create you out of the atoms that you have dispersed into. So don't imagine that if you fall into the sea and you become fish food, that you cannot be resurrected. The graves is a manner of speaking. And he said, you will come forth from your graves in armies. And you will be called unto a place of gathering. Inna yawma al-fasli kana miqata yawma yunfaqu fis-suri fatatuna afwaja wa futihatis samaa'u fakanat abwaaba. He said there will be doors in the skies which will open, through which you will be removed from this land of being. Michio Kaku, one of the students of Albert Einstein, wrote about the Great Crunch. He said when the Great Crunch happens, there is only one way that mankind will have to escape total annihilation, and that is by going out of this dimension. And he said if they can break open and if they can create a door by which they can leave this state of time and space by this dimension, then they can escape total annihilation. And the one who created Michio Kaku and Albert Einstein and their parents and their grandparents, all the way to Adam alayhi salam, if you believe in creation, and all the way to the first monkey, if you believe in Darwin. Right? Your choice. Believe what you want. I know my grandfather wasn't a monkey. What did he say? He said, doors will open in the heavens. I'm not trying to prove the Quran by science. That is a very stupid thing to do. You cannot prove a higher form of knowledge by a lower form of knowledge, logically. You can do the opposite. You can prove a lower form of knowledge by a higher form of knowledge, but you cannot do the opposite. I'm not doing that. I'm just explaining to you what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said. So Allah said, doors will open. وَفُتِحَتِ السَّمَاءُ فَكَانَتْ أَبْوَابًا وَسُيِّرَتِ الْجِبَالُ فَكَانَتْ سَرَابًا. See the beauty of the Quran. Few ayat before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, the jibal, wal jibal awtada, they are the symbol of massiveness, they are the symbol of establishment, they are the symbol of power and weight and force, and they are completely firm. And he said, the same mountains, you will see them floating like clouds. They will have no significance. They will have no weight. وَسُيِّرَتِ الْجِبَالُ فَكَانَتْ سَرَابًا. And then what will happen? The Jahannam will be brought close. How do you know there is Jahannam? Because the one who created it told us it is there. How do you know there is Jannah? Because the one who created us told us it is there. Inna jahannama kanat mirsada littaghina maba labithina fiha haqaba la yadhuquna fiha bardan wala sharaba illa hamiman wa ghassaqa jazaa'an wifaqa. No recompense. Long time to spend there. Very, very hot place. Nothing cool. Nothing nice to drink. Nothing nice to eat. A place of torment and punishment. For whom? For the one who denied all of this. For the one who was born and he breathed the air that Allah created and denied Allah. He drank the water that Allah created and he denied Allah. He took the benefit of his parents and he denied Allah. He took the benefit of intelligence which Allah gave him and he denied Allah. Who took the benefit of the risk and the sustenance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provided and denied Allah. Who spent his time and energy in perpetuating corruption on the face of the earth. Who spent his time and energy breaking the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who spent his time and energy trying to harm Allah and trying to harm the messengers of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says for him, this is just recompense. This is justice. إنهم كانوا لا يرجون حسابا وكذبوا بآياتنا كذابا وكل شيء أحصيناه كتابا فذوقوا فلن نزيدكم إلا عذابا. Taste this and nothing will increase except punishment. And then what about the ones who did not do all of this? What about the intelligent ones who recognized their creator from his science and then who bowed to that creator alone, who did not confuse themselves and who did not worship created things? They worshiped the creator. How do you explain somebody who calls himself intelligent but who bows to something which is created? La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. What about them? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Inna lil muttaqina mafaza hadaiqa wa anaba wa kawaiba turaba wa ka'san dihaqa la yasma'una fiha laghwan wa la kidhaba jaza'an min rabbika ata'an hisaba. This is the reward for them, for their Rabb. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described the beauty and the joys of Jannah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant all of us Jannah bi ghairi hisab, inshaAllah. He described all of this and he said, this is from their Rabb. This is from their Rabb. And who is that Rabb? The ayat of the glory and majesty of my Rabb. رب السماوات والأرض وما بينهما الرحمن. I've always told you people, reflect on the Quran. Reflect on the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have said, رب السماوات والأرض وما بينهما الجبار. Allah could have said, رب السماوات والأرض وما بينهما القهار. He did not say that. الرحمن. The one whose mercy has no boundaries. The one whose mercy is always at the peak and has no boundaries. رَبِّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ وَمَا بَيْنَهُمَا الرَّحْمَنِ لَا يَمْلِكُونَ مِنْهُ خِطَابًا. On which day? يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الرُّوحُ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ صَفًّا لَا يَتَكَلَّمُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ الرَّحْمَنُ وَقَالَ صَوَابًا. On which day? On the day when you will all be gathered. يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الرُّوحُ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ صَفًّا. We will all be gathered on a day when you and I will see what I have recited here, inshallah. Rabbi samawati wal ardi wa ma baynahuma ar-rahman la yamlikuna minhu khitaba yawma yaqumu ar-ruhu wal malaikatu saffa. Jibril alayhi salam and the malaika, the millions and billions and zillions of them, the number of which only Allah knows, will be standing row upon row upon row upon row of angels. And Allah knows what the form of those angels is. Allah knows what the form of the angels is. We do not conjecture and we do not philosophize that the angel looks like this or that. We don't know this. Allah knows what it is. His makhluk. His creation. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be on his throne. And we will all be gathered and driven to the place of gathering like shepherds drive their flock. There will be two angels to every person. They will drive him there. And they will all gather there. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us, make that gathering the best gathering of our lives. We ask Allah to gather us under the shade of his arsh. And there is place for everybody, believe me. This earth is like a grain of sand on a beach. The arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no description. There is place for everybody. We ask Allah to gather all of us and all those who have gone before and all those who are to come under the shade of his arsh on that day. And save us from the fear of that day. On the howl and the wahshat of that day. يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الرُّوحُ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ صَفَّا. And nobody will speak to Allah except by His permission. لَا يَتَكَلَّمُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ نَذِنَ لَهُ الرَّحْمَنِ. And when they speak, they will say only good things. وَقَالَ ثَوَابًا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمُ الْحَقُّ. Verily this day is the day of truth. This day will happen whether we like it or not, whether we believe it or not. Immaterial, want to believe, believe. Don't want to believe, don't believe. Makes no difference to the reality. Just because you don't believe in gravity does not mean that if you jump off this building, you will start flying upwards. You won't. يَوْمَ يَقُومُ الرُّوحُ وَالْمَلَائِكَةُ صَفَّا لَا يَتَكَلَّمُونَ إِلَّا مَنْ أَذِنَ لَهُ الرَّحْمَنُ وَقَالَ صَوَابًا ذَلِكَ الْيَوْمُ الْحَقُّ فَمَنْ شَاءَ اتَّخَذَ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِ مَآبًا. The one who believes, the one who is interested, let him start making some plans for that day. Let him start making a way to his Rabb. My brothers and sisters, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from what is to come. The last ayah of this surah. The ayah of such despair. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from that. Inna أنذرناكم عذابا قريبا يوم ينظر المرء ما قدمت يداه ويقول الكافر يا ليتني كنت ترابا. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, and on that day, those who continued to deny and who died in that state of denial, when they are resurrected on that day, and when they see the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before them, when they see it close, they will not even ask for forgiveness. Their despair will be such that they will not even ask for forgiveness. They will say, Ya laytani kuntu turab. They will say, if only I was dust. If only I did not exist. If only I was never born. And that is why I always say, the saddest phrase, the saddest two words in any language are if only. Because if only means, ya laytani, if only means that time to make a change is gone. There is no if only when there is time to change. Because you can say, well, you know, right now you want to do something, do it. We have time. As long as we are breathing, we have time. Let us do it. Let us take the steps. Because the time will come. A time will come when this window will shut. And nobody can stop it from shutting. And nobody can stop us from going into that world. Believe me. Take my word for it. Until the time comes, it won't happen. And when the time comes, it cannot be stopped. And then, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save all of us who are here. And all of those who are related to those who are here. And all of those who are not related to those who are here. All of humankind. From this one ayah. From the meaning of this one ayah. From this level of despair. Where the person will say, I wish I was dust. I wish I was dust. If only I was dust. Then I would not have to face this punishment which I am seeing here. Ya laytani kuntu turaba. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين ربنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب وصلى الله على نبي الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين والحمد لله رب العالمين. Please stand up and come inside here.